Good morning. Hope you had a good 4th of July. Hope the rain held off for those of you, and you could see some fireworks yesterday. Today is July 5th. It's Tuesday, and first full week of the second quarter. Well, I guess first 4 days of the second quarter, third quarter. The big thing that I want to touch on today is the recession. And the one that we are in. The Atlanta Fed tracks the data that's coming in on an ongoing basis. And so we have a little bit more of a real-time flavor on what actual GDP we're actually coming out with right now. In Q1, obviously, the official number was down. And in Q2, for a while, we were positive. That is now officially sunk to negative 2.1% for Q2 after some weak manufacturing data on Friday. So negative 2.1%. So even worse than the 1.5% decline in Q1. Within that number, a lot of the weakness was attributable to the ISM manufacturing report. You have the headline that was down to 53 from 56.1. You have prices that actually decelerated to 78.5, down from 82.2. You're probably starting to see that a little bit in commodities, excluding oil. But really concerning, I would say, is the new orders and employment. New orders fell dramatically to 49.2. That was from 55.1. So new orders are actually contracting officially now, and that's on the manufacturing side. Employment is contracting in a bigger way. It's down to 47.3 from 49.6. So a big 2.3 point contraction there. It was expected to actually increase. And so we went, instead of going from 49.6 to 50, we fell from 49.6 to 47.3. Some of the commentary also is a little bit concerning. Again, we've been following a lot of what individual companies have been saying for the last number of months. So it's not terribly surprising, but it's now definitely hitting some of the national data. They're saying that the backlog is high, but incoming orders are slowing. They're saying that our suppliers are experiencing a softening of orders, still running at the same high level we did throughout 2021 and early 2022, but again, softening of orders. And then hearing from customers that their inventories are high and sales are coming down, we expect orders to decline in the coming months until inventories are leveled properly against demand. Anecdotally, I was actually in Target yesterday on Barrett, and you'd think a Target on Barrett Parkway, one of the main shopping areas of North Atlanta, you'd think that would be fairly full at noon. On July 4th, people getting the last minute July 4th supplies, et cetera. It was about as empty as I've ever seen a Target, and certainly over the past number of years. And that includes really some of the pandemic months as well. Just dramatically empty. They still had Father's Day stuff. Father's Day isn't for another 49 weeks. So we've got a long time. Target definitely seems like it has an abundance of inventory right now, and it's some of the problems there. Citigroup is actually warning that oil may collapse to $65 by year end if there is a recession. Citi, for some reason, doesn't actually expect a recession, but says that oil prices fall in all recessions to roughly the marginal cost. So the big takeaway here is something that we touched about on Wednesday when Tom was here. And he and I were talking about it with respect to Bed Bath & Beyond, and noted we're shifting from an environment of stagflation to an environment of full-out recession. So whereas real growth can slow, but inflation makes it look like things are doing okay, we're now shifting to a point of we're slowing to a degree that even inflated dollars can't make it look good. And so the way we have to manage through that is taking our time, but buying good businesses that are going to make it through it and actually emerge stronger. So you think about the last recession and the companies that actually emerged stronger after the crisis than before the crisis. You think about a company like JP Morgan. It was a good bank before the crisis, but then after absorbing a couple other banks, absorbing Washington Mutual, it was actually in a stronger position coming out of it, especially relative to companies like Citigroup, which didn't have that fortitude to get through the recession properly. So you really see the sorting of the wheat from the chaff in an environment like this, and we're trying to find the good roots and that will grow fastest when we do emerge out of this. So that's what we're looking to do. And if you read our market memos that we send out now on a weekly basis on Fridays, we're trying to find more and more businesses that end up doing that. For as bad as it is in the US, it's actually worse in Europe. Currencies are really getting hit very hard right now. The euro is down to 103. And if you think that, hey, I remember when the euro was 130. Yeah, you're right. That wasn't that long ago. But right now, as I look at it, 1.0286 right now on the euro. So Europeans really feeling it hard. The British pound looks a bit like a wet paper bag. So what they call it in trading is you just kind of throw rocks at the wettest of the paper bags. And that's right now the British pound and the euro. And so all these people who are looking to short or actually profit in this environment, they're looking to short the pound, they're looking to short the euro because there's just gravity that's taking it down. And you might as well put a few more rocks in that paper bag until it breaks. And I do think that on the euro especially will probably hit and will go to at least parity, which would be incredibly significant, really, if the euro hit parity. This is the lowest level the euro's been for 20 years. So if you're planning a European trip, that's good news for you because a lot of their products will seem cheaper now than they did just a few months ago. Elsewhere in Europe, SAS, which is the largest Scandinavian airline, they're going through bankruptcy issues. They're in, quote, well-advanced discussions with a number of lenders to secure debtor-in-possession financing for up to $700 million. To give you a sense of the scale of this company, it's about the same size as Spirit Airlines in terms of assets. They already restructured back in 2020, but it obviously didn't do enough. They said that the recovery has been hurt by personnel costs, high debt, and strikes, especially on the pilot side. So they're trying to convert about $2 billion of outstanding debt into stock. And they're also trying to raise an additional $1 billion of equity. So we're already beginning to see in this environment, some companies become extremely distressed. We talked about Bed Bath & Beyond last week, SAS obviously this morning, and then finally Uniper, which is one of the largest German utilities. It's about a $9 billion company in terms of total enterprise value, $4 billion market cap. And what's crazy is they need $9 billion to keep the doors open. That's how much this Russian gas issue is causing an issue. So essentially what Uniper does is it purchases cheap Russian gas, or what used to be cheap Russian gas, and then converts it into electricity and sells it to the German people. The problem is cheap Russian gas is no longer cheap. So Uniper is really getting squeezed on the cost side. They're losing about $30 to $35 million a day, and they need to find a way to keep the doors open. So the German government is looking like it's preparing a bailout. So Uniper is actually up 11% this morning after falling dramatically over the last few weeks. But they're looking to bail out Uniper as well as some of the other utility companies with a set of measures. They're including loans. They're going to actually, the German government's going to take an equity stake. So similar to what the US did with General Motors back in 2008. When General Motors went bankrupt. And they're also looking to pass part of the surge in costs onto consumers. So you're going to continue to see this inflation impetus in Europe. And that's going to continue to push the European Central Bank to raise interest rates, even though the economy is slowing and slowing dramatically. And again, this is why the euro is weakening so much, because they can simply not afford to handle the higher natural gas prices that the Russians are putting on them. And really, they've kind of imposed on themselves. The German economy minister, Robert Habeck, we talked a bit about this last week as well. He's warned that the gas crunch risks triggering a collapse in the market, similar to the role of Lehman Brothers in the financial crisis. And frankly, an economy that is so reliant on Russian gas as Germany, which is predominantly an industrial economy. You think of all the big industrial companies, obviously the automakers, but also your fertilizer companies, BASF, a lot of these chemicals companies, they're all relying on natural gas as feedstock, and that cost is going up factors. Not just percent, but factors, multiple times what the cost structure was, is making them uncompetitive. And it's really forcing the hand of a lot of these companies. So Uniper is looking to get bailed out. Elsewhere, over here, Tesla did have production numbers that were a little bit better than expected, although still down from the first quarter due to the shutdowns in Shanghai related to COVID. There was a story over the weekend that President Biden is looking to ease some of those Chinese tariffs that President Trump put on about 4 years ago. It's a narrow balancing act for him. He's trying to ease inflation, but still looking tough on China. They say an announcement could come this week that could maybe help some inflation at the margin, although I don't expect it to take place certainly immediately anyway. But bear in mind, again, that the big issue now, inflation should have been something that we talked about in Q2, in Q1. We're shifting from an environment of inflation as the epicenter to recession as the epicenter. And so we're kind of fighting the last battle. Whenever we're talking about now about oil prices or gasoline prices here in the United States, it is what it is at this point. We might have some retrenchment on it. We might have some things that we can do at the margin, but the demand issue is now taking center stage. And that's not to say that inflation isn't a problem, but the epicenter is now shifting to demand, which makes Jay Powell's comments. There was an article in the Wall Street Journal kind of leaking what the Federal Reserve is thinking right now. And they say, the Fed is willing to risk recession now to avoid much worse recession later. And I do think that that is what's going on right now. I do think that recession is becoming the big point, even more so than inflation. And I think that the Federal Reserve now is, again, just like the president, trying to fight inflation when recession is really the issue at the moment. And I think that at this point, it's going to be a very, very tough balancing act for any policymaker to really solve both issues simultaneously. Recession definitely seems to be the way things are going. Later this week, we do have, and especially tomorrow, we have in the morning ISM, so that we'll have the ISM services report. So the big one that revised GDP down for Q2 was the manufacturing report on Friday. We have the services report tomorrow. Again, services is an even larger piece of the economy. So if that comes in worse than expected, expect another GDP revision downward for Q2. And I mean, we could be pushing down 3% for the quarter if that comes in as bad as the manufacturing report come in. Then we also have the JOLTS report, the job openings report for the month of April. So definitely looking a little bit further back there, but we do have job openings on being reported tomorrow. And then at 2 p.m., we have the minutes from the last Fed meeting, and that'll come out at 2 p.m. So tomorrow is a busy day during the day for economic data. So we'll talk all about that on Thursday. And then, of course, on Friday, we have the big unemployment rate number for the month of June, which could mean the first meaningful tick up in unemployment rate since COVID. So that'll be an important one to watch as well. So with that, I hope you have a great week. Just keep your head down out there, and best of luck. And we'll be here tomorrow, and Andrew and Tom will be back. Have a good one.